Good evening. I'm Nalin. I'm a business coach, and I will speak today on how leadership needs to be different or not different in times of adversity. My session would last about 40-45 minutes, and at the end of the session, I will answer your questions. You will see a chat box or a question box, you know, so you can write your questions as and when they come to your mind. But I will then and answer all of them at the end of my talk. Also, in case there are some questions left, not to worry. I will make sure that my email ID is with you, and you will be able to access me to have any further discussion that may be necessary. So let me begin. Times are not good. We have a lockdown. All the factories, businesses are shut. You know, there is a bit of uncertainty when they will open. Perhaps many of you have nothing to do, and some of you also kind of feel helpless that it's not in your hands. So let's look at, you know, an example of a Chilean mining disaster. This happened about 10 years ago, about 69 days. These 33 miners were stuck at 2,300 feet below ground, mostly darkness. They really didn't have any idea whether they will ever get rescued. So they didn't know they will live through it. For most part, there was no communication and, you know, very limited food. I think we need to feel a lot of gratitude that we are safe. We have shelter, we have enough food. There are millions in our country who don't have this basic necessities also. And friends, unlike the 33 Chilean miners, we can all see light at the end of the tunnel. We know this lockdown is a bit uncertain, but yeah, my guess, you know, we have problems for 90 days, maybe give and take 10 days here and there. Maybe lockdown gets extended, business takes a little more time. But from the experience of China and, you know, wherever there is a tapering down, we can figure out that it's a 3 month game. You know, we can see some hope for sure. But these miners, I cannot even guess, you know, what kind of, what state of despair they would have been down below. So let me start with a question. I would have actually conducted a poll, but there's a kind of a shortage of bandwidth. So the poll may not go through. So I will ask you a question. And the answers are obvious. Compared to the Chilean miners, are we worse off or better off? That's the question. Compared to the Chilean miners, are we worse off or better off? I am sure almost 100% of you will believe and will answer that we are comparatively better off than the Chilean miners. Well, these guys came out alive and in good shape. Friends, the mine collapsed on August 5, and they came out alive and in good shape on October 13, a full 2 months and 20 days, after being inside. So you think the Chilean miners did some magical stuff? I mean, did they do some, something extraordinarily different inside? You know, if you look at what all they did, the answer is no. They did quite a few obvious things to survive. And I mean, if we don't go through this presentation, you will be able to list them out. But whatever they did in extremely difficult, uncertain and life-threatening circumstances. And I guess that's where lies the greatness of these people. They also did that with very firmly and with determination in those circumstances. And I think that's what really stands them apart. So they did obvious things. So on this presentation, I mean, you can expect what? I would say you will get some blinding flashes of the obvious. Don't expect one single big formula. Expect BFOs, blinding flashes of the obvious. And what is the BFO actually? In a scientific term, it's that aha moment where our brain makes a connection between two previously known but unconnected bits of information. So you know them, they're there, but you just don't put them together. So in my talk today, I hope, I'm able to help stimulate some of these for all of us who are attending this webinar. So that's what I feel you should get today, a few BFOs. I'm going to organize my talk in five buckets. The first bucket, and I think the most important one, is self. You as businessmen also, apart from controlling yourself, and self with a capital, you also have the responsibility to lead your team. Very important. And as business owners, you will also have to demonstrate your grit, not only for your team, in front of your team, but also in front of your customers and vendors. You also have to stand tall in your community. Of course, the resources are going to be scarce, there is no business, and therefore, you have also to take full charge of your resources. So let's start with the most important one, self. And let me take you back into that mine, where the miners were. Urzua was their foreman and their leader. So for him, the command challenges began within moments of collapse. Please read what's written there. The first thing he did was he took three miners and scouted the tunnel, searching for information on this massive collapse. Once he concluded that there was no way out and they are actually trapped, he quickly ordered his men into a huddle. He quickly thought through and instituted a set of rules and regulations. He didn't lose any time, huh? And these rules and regulations were methodically rigid and crucial to the men's survival. So he did that immediately. So the point I'm asking here is that, what do you think he did? Did he start in his mindset by blaming the mine owners for being negligent? Did he get into a state of denial? Ki sab kuch theek ho jayega, things will be all right very soon. Did he show helplessness to his team? Ki we can't do anything, there's nothing we can do, let's wait and watch. Hopefully somebody comes and helps us. No, obviously not. He did assume responsibility and accountability for the situation. So no poll question here, it's very obvious. We saw the previous slide. He immediately took up the challenge, and we know that at the end of 69 days, these miners came out pretty much safe and in good health. So obviously, he built within himself a solid positive attitude. And with that, he stayed above the point of power. He didn't go below and feel powerless. It's written as bed. Blame, excuses, denial. He actually took charge of the ship. He took hold of the oar. He took ownership, responsibility, and accountability, and started acting from the point of power. What can I do in these circumstances, how best we can survive in these circumstances. So need I say, dear business owner, the first thing you have to do is to your own self. And here I write and use the word self in caps. You have to find your ways to stay above the point of power. There is lockdown, factories are shut, business is not happening. But you have to take responsibility and accountability on what can you do under the circumstances. Now, staying positive or staying above the point of power is a very personal thing. Different people have different ways of doing it. You know, I've seen people who exercise to stay, positive. Some meditate. There are people, you know, who have rituals to stay positive. Some socialize. They discuss ideas with friends and family. And that's what gives them a lot of energy and positivity. Some get down to the task instantly. You know, that's the way they feel positive. Instead of brooding, thinking, talking, they just get down. All of these ways are fine. You need to find your way how you can stay positive in your mindset. The other day, my colleague Tavish was telling me that she is determined to wake up, work and sleep at the same time as she used to do before the lockdown. You know, this was her way, little small way, to keep her mindset positive and keep herself in a fighting fit spirit. So, friends, you have to figure out what works for you. But as business owner, you have to build a very positive mindset. You have to stay above the point of power. So we had all agreed in the poll, you know, in the question that we are really, really, really much better off than the miners who were trapped. So what are we supposed to do? We are trapped in a lockdown, no doubt. As a leader, we have to get our wits together and plan our course without losing any time. We have to take charge now. We have to create a mission for ourselves. We have to create a mission for our business. And not only that, that mission, whatever we take, has to become actionable in form of quantifiable goals. So I would say give yourself a very, very positive attitude to start with. It's important. It's critical. Now, sometimes to stay positive, you need to take a personal mission. And I will soon come to a few examples of these, which will, I guess, stimulate your thinking. And also, you have to make sure that your business has a 90-day mission. Here again, I will talk some examples. And this mission, if you don't convert into proper goals, then I think, it will just remain on paper. So you have to make sure that this mission is easily converted into very smart goals, and quantifiable goals and achievable goals and, realistic goals. So you need to do that. I would, of course, say that the business mission has to be in some ways a part of your, overall plan for the year. Let's look at some of the personal missions to start with, and then I'll come back to business mission. Some of the examples can be, I'll become proficient in finance. Now we are, many of us are technocrats. We will start a business, and maybe this is a good time to become very proficient in reading financial statements, financial ratios, balance sheet, things like that. Or we may want to acquire people skills, how to select people, how to assess people, how to do a performance management appraisal, how to give bad news to people. There are many people skills that you require in the course of running your business. There are many online sources today available. There are many courses. There are many, many things that you can do. There are plenty of opportunities for you to learn. Some of us, we are at an age when we were young. We didn't have much of internet, social media, etc. And then we got into work. So maybe you want to take a personal goal of learning how to leverage social media. So things like that, or even some goals like meditation, learn music. So the point is, you have to figure out whatever is going to help you stay positive, whatever is going to give you a lot of energy and a lot of strength to do the things that you know you need to do under these circumstances. Some of the examples of business goals, you know, you could have a vision, a mission, I would say. It's a 90-day thing. To become a very process-driven organization, you know, you could say in these 90 days, my team will write processes, you know, for quality, processes for sales, processes for marketing. You could also take a goal that I will convert my organization, complete organization, you know, make it very, very customer-oriented. You know, thing is that we have a lot of frontline salespeople, and they always say that they don't get enough support from backend. The backend doesn't understand that customer is demanding in these days and stuff like that. So you could take that as a goal for your 90 days, a mission. You could look at quality and attack quality. There is a great need to go online anyways, you know, a new way of doing business. That could be one of your goals, that in this 90 days, we'll figure out. And, you know, we take a mission to become ready for an online business model. So stuff like that, I would say, you need to figure out. My strong suggestion here would be that whatever mission you take, you have to make sure that it aligns with your annual goals. You know, I'm sure you have some improvement goals apart from your revenue and profit and sales goals for the year. So select something, you know, which will be extremely useful and a part of your annual goal. Even missions like, I will use this time to do brand building in social media may be relevant to many businesses. I am getting some regular messages from a travel company which is now pushing and selling me some winter destinations. You know, they're giving me packages for winter, and you know, if I want to book now, I get some very attractive offers and discounts. If I book now with some advance, I lock myself, you know. So I just called the gentleman the other day, and he said that given this situation, the travel may not happen for a very long time, and he has taken a mission to get one of the best market shares in the winter packages. And he said that he has given specific targets to his salespeople as well as to his sub agents, and he even said that these targets are segment wise. You know, he has their own way of segmenting his market, and he said his targets are segment wise, and he wants to book. He also said that he is using this period to improve his online presence, because tourism business is going more and more online. Amazing. We have a client, he is in engineering services, and he has taken a mission to be the most preferred suppliers for his customers. So what is he doing? He has decided to achieve that mission by doing customer relationship building activities. He's conducting design training for the trainee engineers of the customers, the young engineers of the customers. He is giving them training on some of the techniques to design. And it is his goal, he said, that he wants to do at least one training for each of his key customers during this period. Of course, he's doing it online. And he says at the end of this, his mission, he has about 4 competitors in the market. He says at the end of this period, his mission is to be the most preferred supplier for design engineering services. So I think there are these are some of the goals which align, you know, with the annual goal of the organization, and they actually make the organization stronger. So if you want help in setting up your 90-day mission and SMART goals, I'll be happy to engage. Please feel free to mail me, if you need support. And, my own mission is to become known in SME circles as a coach with a strategic mindset. So please feel free to mail me if you think I can help you. Before I move to the next section, I have few more important things to say on the self, and I would like you to answer this question for me. Before the lockdown, when the operations were normal, what percentage of your time you would spend on managing a day-to-day crisis? You're living and running your plant, you're running your operations. Was it 25% or less? Was it between 25 and 50%? Or was it greater than 50%? While I said that I'm not able to run the poll because of some bandwidth issues, there are 120 of you here today, and I'm really grateful that you're all there. But let me sort of guess the answer, and I'm sure most of you will agree. Most of you will answer definitely above 25%, if not above 50%. So you were spending, in operations time, handling some urgent thing or some important urgent crisis thing, and which was not so important but urgent to handle. So here is my final advice to you on self. See, we do spend a lot of time in firefighting in quadrant one, and it's important. I'm not saying that. But now, that operations are much less, so that time is now spare. And it's very easy to fall down to distractions and time-wasting activity, whether it's mails or it is even Netflix or whatever. And it's same way for your team also. So how do you ensure that you do some quality activity in this period also, and you stay in quadrant two? You do some capability improvement or relationship building, or look at some new opportunities, new business models, do some planning, even recreation of the positive side. So I say that to you business owners, it is very important to give yourself a 90-day mission, because when you do that, you remain a lot in quadrant two. So you have the time and opportunity, and you have the need, because you are in a lockdown situation. So you have the time and opportunity and the need, to stay in quadrant two. So give yourself a 90-day mission. That's my final advice to you on self. Let's take the opportunity to move to the next bucket. The next bucket is a team, a very important bucket in itself. And to understand what we have to do for the team, let's get into that mine and join those 30 miners again. Urzua took charge underground, dividing the habitat into separate areas for sleeping, working and washing. He immediately kind of started organizing them. He instilled a sense of structure and order among his men, who he admitted had been initially overcome by desperation. The initial reaction would have been absolute desperation, and he quickly instilled a sense of structure and order in them. So you're getting that parallel, right? You understand what's happening. Urzua split his men into groups and to build the team spirit. Immediately he did all that, He also started to map the tunnels, that could be useful later on for his survival, their survival, and even help in the rescue. So friends, you have to give your team a very inspiring mission. Well, we all agreed that we are much better off here, while we are trapped in a lockdown. But as a leader, we have to get our wits together, and we have to plan our course of action without losing any time at all. So we don't have to infect our team with the corona paralysis. you know, we have to actually give them an infectious inspiration. We have to make sure that you convert their 90-day mission, you give them an inspiring 90-day vision, and also that mission is converted into SMART goals, simple, measurable, achievable, tangible, relevant goals. We are able to convert that mission into achievable goals. You may also involve your team, you know, to make these goals. In some cases, you know, you may want to do that. And then you have to get the action plan made. And I'm certain that for action plan, you need to get the teams involved. You have to make individuals make their action plans. You have to assign them the goals. And remember, some of these actions will be co-dependent on other team members. It's very important. It's very important to point out those actions, you know, because that will foster a lot of team spirit in your team. And I can tell you, adverse times is the best time to bring the teams together. So I would say that there should be quite a few actions, you know, which are co-dependent on other team members, and the team members have to work together to achieve those actions and therefore the goals. Make sure, you know, we organize a structure in this new way of working. Maybe a simple one-page work from home policy. You know, you have to be dressed. You know, you have to be in a quiet place in the house. You have to log in at XYZ time. You have to be polite. This is still like an office, not like a home. You have to be undisturbed. Maybe you have a review meeting, you know, at 9:30, and you say everybody has to be there at 9:30. You may want to put in the policy that everybody should download Skype or Zoom, or, you know, standardize the package by which you will conduct. So you may just want to issue a policy and things like that, and you may even set an agenda for a review meeting in the morning that you will send some special item of discussion, and everybody will present their action plans. So give a structure to your team. So I kind of would love to repeat this. Don't give them corona paralysis. Give them an inspiring, infectious 90-day mission, which is a part of your overall plan. They should know that they are adding value by doing this. That's very important. Huh? They should feel that they are doing, moving towards their annual target in that sense. And these were anyway going to strengthen the organization. So it has to be useful, and therefore it has to be transferred into proper goals and proper action plan, and give them a decent structure so they know what rules to follow, what to do, what not to do. So that's important for your team. Let's get back into the mine again for some time. Urzua credit majority decision making for the trapped men's good spirits. Good spirits is important, and dedication to their common goal. You know, so that's very, very critical. You just have to speak the truth, he said, and believe in democracy. Can you beat that? You just have to be honest and truthful and believe in democracy. Few more statements. He kept his men occupied, 12-hour shift, and maintained strict discipline. So that's the kind of thing he did as a team leader down in those circumstances. So I would say you have to give your team a lot of communication. You know, in adverse time, we need to really increase communication with the team many fold. Remember, they are also feeling lost, and they are feeling perhaps much more lost than you are as a business owner. So you have to increase the frequency of communication. You have to increase the frequency of review. You have given them an action plan. You have given them the goals. You need to review them rather more frequently than necessary. So I would actually recommend very easily that it should be a daily meeting. You know, it should be a daily video meeting, and maybe one more phone call meeting towards the end of the day. And maybe for some employees, some additional communication you may have to do, those who are, you know, you think require a little more push. So I would say communicate many times. You have to also make sure that the action plan is detailed and everyone has enough tasks. Remember Urzua, everybody had a 12-hour job inside when they were trapped. So make sure that they have enough tasks in hand. You could even give some self-development targets to your team. For instance, we spoke about customer orientation in the whole organization. You could actually ask finance people to read some articles on sales or some book on sales and actually ask them to submit, present a gist of what they learned to everybody else. So you could do a variety of activities which are related to self-development of the team, and that would obviously add to the quality of your organization. Sales people could understand costing better, back-end people could understand the front-end better. And there are, as I said, many courses available. So you make sure that, your 90-day mission has a lot of daily tasks and people have to, work a lot. I just want to remind you again, Urzua ensured that each man had 12 hours of work. The next point I want to make is, sometimes you may have to take some hard calls. It's possible that, the affordability issues happen. You may have to tell the team that, the salaries will go down. You may have to put them on a sustenance allowance. I won't recommend that you should retrench anybody, because it's a short-term thing. And it's very difficult to get people, and it's very expensive to get people, much more expensive than a few months' salary to get a new person, train him, teach him. And don't forget that immediately after the lockdown, you have to get back into business fast. So I won't say that you should really retrench anybody. But yeah, if there were one or two people you anyway thought that you want to, remove, this may be the best time. The point here is, one, you have to be very transparent and honest with the team while expressing what you are doing and why you are doing. And the second point is, it's better to do it now than later, because team is sensing anyway that things are not going well and something may happen. They'll be always under stress. So it's better to tell them that the worst is over, and I'm transparently and honestly expressing to you, this is what I think will work. This is how I can support you. This is what I want from you. And if you do that upfront, you will get much better productivity and energy on the team than if you try to postpone it or kind of wishy-washy it. So please be upfront, transparent and honest. And make sure that every member of the team is pushed, because you may find some are more forthcoming, they will always act faster. There may be some, who are a little hesitant in this new environment. They can't adjust to the change. So make sure that you push for participation of every team member, and that's quite critical especially in adverse kind of circumstances. So I will take a little break and ask you another question here. This is something that you need to ponder over. Do you think during lockdown or adverse kind of circumstances, you need to be extra soft with your team? You understand the question, right? You need to be extra soft with your team when things get tough. Now, I know there may be a split answer here. Some of you will feel yes, some of you perhaps will say no. But let me give you my opinion here. I don't think so. I don't think so that you have to be an extra soft. I would say you don't at all have to be extra soft in adverse times, or for that matter, even extra harsh. So do not become a shark, creating panic and pushing people and, threatening people and don't become a dog either. Accepting almost anything the employee says, wagging your tail to anything and everything just to keep them happy. I don't think any of these strategies will work. And worst of all, don't be a tortoise. Don't go into a shell where you are not, you're not visible. So I would say be very, very visible to your team. That's why I'm saying video. communicate, communicate, and communicate. And I would say, no, don't get soft, don't get harsh. You must maintain the normal high employee orientation and high task orientation. That's the most motivating stance a boss can take. High employee orientation and high task orientation during this adverse period also. Okay, so let's move a bit to the external world. The customer, and the vendor, they are external to the organization. Let me move to the next slide. And maybe you want to read this and absorb it for a minute. After many, many, many days of no hope, no contact, in his first audio contact with officials on the surface, he glossed over. He did not mention about hunger, despair, and the difficulties his men are facing inside. He instead of that said, "We are fine and we are waiting for you to rescue us." What a quality, what a class. We are fine. We are waiting for you to rescue us. Maybe you want to mull over this slide also. So once communication was established, there were typically three briefings every day. There was a doctor both ways, and there was a mining expert, an engineering expert who would update on how to rescue and what's happening for rescue. And also there was a psychologist. So these kind of updates would happen every day, okay, three times a day, three different kind of updates. And in one of the daily call, look at the self-confidence of Urzua. When doctor was talking to him, he's telling the doctor, "Keep it short. We have lots of work to do. We have lots of work to do." So friends, you have to give your customer as well as vendor a big, big dose of confidence, a huge dose of confidence. Your customer and vendor must know that you are fighting fit, that you are using this time to get stronger, that you will be ready, and very important, you will be ready to support them as soon as the lockdown is over. And actually, in some areas, you will actually get better. It's very important that he understands, that at the end of lockdown, you're not going to be dead. You're going to be full of life. He can depend on you. If he wants something, some service from you, he can depend on you. If he wants a product from you, he can depend on you. The vendor will know that he will buy from you. So you have to make sure that they know that, you are fighting fit, you're working hard. So don't hesitate to share your 90-day mission with them. Actually, go ahead and explain them the complete 90-day mission. Give them a full overview of what you are trying to do. I gave you the example of this engineering service fellow who is going out of the way to service the client. So do something. Do give an additional level of service to your customers, because that will give them a clear indication that you are fighting. And also, many of us, we think kya kya marketing karna hai. Please redouble your efforts of marketing. I gave you the example of the travel house. Please redouble your efforts to market. And that is what I can guarantee when the winter time comes. This gentleman who is now pushing, even if I don't book now, he will be the first man in my head if I want to book, let's say, in October. So please redouble your efforts of marketing. This is the best time to do that. Redouble your efforts of servicing. Redouble your efforts of marketing. And also make sure that you communicate with your client and vendors many, many times more. If you are talking to your main clients once a month, please talk every 3 days. Give them an update on your 90-day mission. Give them an update. Ask them how you can do better service in these circumstances. Take their advice. What can you do to, do a better marketing or better brand building? How are you progressing on the mission? Make sure that you communicate with them many, many times more than you used to communicate earlier. It's quite critical. Okay, let's move to the next bucket, which is the resources. Critical. Okay, read this. Urzua tried to instill a philosophical acceptance of fate, so they could accept their situation and move on to embrace the essential task of survival. We all know that resources are going to be scarce. We are sure of that. Resources are going to be scarce. And there has to be some bit of acceptance of that particular. On the other hand, you have to take action immediately. They rationed water and food immediately. They used backhoes to dig for water. Some they got from radiator of vehicles. The men used truck batteries to power their hat lamps. A truck as an office they were using, and they were turning the lights of other trucks on and off to simulate daylight. So friends, you have to conserve your resources. There is no way out, especially cash. Cash is going to be very, very scarce. Remember, at the end of the lockout, you have to bounce back. You have to quickly ramp up your production. You have to quickly buy raw material, get some orders, execute those orders. So you need to work out what amount you need in hand at the end of the lockout to bounce back quickly. Because those who will bounce back quickly will gain a lot. Their gains will go way beyond even the year, So please look at every item, every line very, very microscopically. No amount is insignificant. If you have a broadband bill coming in your office, office is shut down, and if your plan allows, please put that in cold, in sleeping mode. Maybe you can save some monthly bill. Maybe you can talk to your landlord, discuss some reduction in rent or abeyance, a moratorium on rent, and you will pay it later. Whatever. Go item by item, line by line, brainstorm with your team if you have to, think of how you can reduce the cost, because you will have to really, really conserve money. Banks have opened out. There have been some good cash influx in the economy by the RBI policy. So don't wait for the lockdown to get over or indications of it to get over. Please approach the banks immediately with your plans, how you are going to quickly ramp up, what you are doing in this period, and get your additional OD limits, get your additional loan sanctions. Do it now. Garner whatever possible resources you can now. Don't wait till the water comes this level. Do it now. You also must make a cash flow statement right away as to how much is likely to be the cash outflow. You have already discussed the things with your team. You have discussed your line by line savings. You have figured out what you can and what you can't. And so please work out a cash flow requirement for the 90-day period and the reserve that you require to reboot. A very, very important factor. You must do that because it's very important to reboot very quickly. And you must do it today. Don't wait. I must say that Urzua didn't wait for the water stock to deplete. On the very first day, the moment he realized that they are trapped, he instituted one of the teams to go and look for water and immediately started rationing water. So that activity about backhoe and finding water in various radiators, he instituted on the very first hour of him getting trapped. So don't wait, please. Don't lose any time. Do prepare your cash flow statement. Do prepare your 90-day outflow as well as the amount that you will require. And try to garner whatever you can. I'm getting messages from Karachi Sweets. He's got some inventory probably, and he's delivering home things like khakra, yevo. Maybe he's manufacturing also a few new things, but I am getting constant, and I bought also. So he's obviously succeeding, to convert some of his inventory into cash and making sure that things don't go waste. So please do whatever necessary to garner, do whatever necessary to conserve. It's important. Okay, so we come to the next bucket and my last bucket, which is community. My friends, it's important to understand that gratuity and humility is something that builds positively. You know, when you do something for the community, I don't know whether community gains, of course they gain, but I think you gain much more yourself. You gain a lot of spiritual strength. So I encourage you to do some work for the community period. Let your team also get involved in community work in whichever way they can. It's a win-win situation to work for the community, especially in adverse times. You are helping those who are desperately in need of help, and you are building gratitude, humility within yourself. And that straight away leads to the positivity, my first bucket on self. When you know how lucky you are compared to others, you really realize that what you have is a big gift, and there are millions of people who don't have even that. So please create equally, with equal effort, a 90-day plan to serve the community in every which way. Your small team members, they don't have to just give money. They can help an old couple, who can't go to the market to do their shopping. They can help a maid or a driver with a meal, maybe a daily wager by giving him some work. So please make sure that you create a 90-day plan for the community. And you also make sure that your team is involved, and even family is involved, even for children. It's such a nice thing to teach them. So let's do something for the community in this adverse circumstances. I'm quite sort of close to an end and going to summarize now. I had spoke about these five buckets to you. Let me sort of give you a poll star for each of this bucket. And I say poll star because, if ever you are confronted with the alternatives, you have to take A or B and you are confused, I think poll star is something that will give you direction and help you to choose between those alternatives. Let me start with community. My poll star for community is humility. Be humble, have that feeling of gratitude that you have much more than many, many other people have. When it comes to self, I would say positivity. If you have to do A or B and you think A will make you feel more positive, please do A. And under no circumstances, do something that will not make you feel positive. When it comes to team, it's really unity. I spoke about codependent actions, they build unity. Please don't do anything which can kind of damage the team unity in these hours. Team needs each other and this is the best time to build unity. So my poll star for you, when you have to make a choice between route A or route B, think what route will improve unity in team and go for that route. When it comes to customer and vendor, you have to become a trustworthy business partner. The vendor and the customer should know that he can trust you to support him during a bad time, as well as even in good times for that matter, when the lockdown gets lifted, he should know that you will be fighting for it. So whatever you do for your customer and vendor, straight away see that if I do this, will it build more trust? Will he consider me more trustworthy? So the poll star for customer and vendor is trustworthy. And friends, when it comes to resources, it's brevity. You have to take it very seriously. You have to control. And that's what I would say is the poll star for resources. I'm just about to end, but I have one last question for you. Some of us are kind of in a wait and watch game. So do you think there is no urgency after listening to my talk? And you can wait to see how things pan out before you act on these suggestions? I mean, do you think we can just wait for a week or two and figure out? No. I don't know what your answer is, but I think most of you will say no. You have to act now. My friends, it's my strong advice to you. This is the time to get into action. Don't wait, act now. Thank you very much for listening to me. It was wonderful experience for me also, you know, to speak my mind with all of you. I'm glad that you all stayed in the webinar till the end. As some of you have posted questions, and let me read them and try to sort of club them together and spend the next 8-9 minutes in trying to answer them. And as I said, my email ID is here, and you're very much free to contact me. Okay, so the questions. So a lot of questions on how to maintain employees, how to manage cash, yeah, how to survive. So yeah, so as I said that, retrenching the employee is the last option for more than one reason. First, it's not easy to get a good employee and then train him, and it's extremely expensive to do it. It's not as if this lockdown is for a year. It's clearly 2 to 3, 3.5 months, or maybe a little here and there. So, the cost of paying him now versus cost of getting a new employee, training him, could be very difficult. Last but not least, remember that the moment business picks up, you will have to ramp up very fast. And nothing like a trained employee who understands you. There's a team spirit already. He works with other people. He knows your work. He knows his team members. He knows where to get support. So if you lose some experienced and old employees and then try to recoup and reboot with fresh employees, it's very difficult. So I would say no retrenchment. I would say that. Having said that, you obviously have a cash resource, cash crunch. You have to take a call. So I would say, you should have a frank and honest discussion with your team. Maybe reduce their perks and salaries for the time being. Give them a sustenance allowance so that they can live and survive, and they still feel motivated and attached to you. And and manage. So you have to do your calculation. Go to the banks, take whatever you can. I think go line by line item, cut every possible cost. I think employee is the last item that you need to touch in this area, because the cost of that is going to be humongous. Humongous means you would lose the opportunity for the year also, because those who ramp up faster, customer will go to them and continue to go to them. So that way. Okay, so there are more questions on cash. I think I stand by what I've said. There the question is, the government expected to give some more the government announced earlier some things for the lowest of the, poorest of the poor in terms of direct cash support. And then later on, RBI has given a set of measures to help the business community. You can get loans easy, your EMIs have been kept in abeyance. Because the RBI has forced cash onto the banks, so banks are likely to be easy, I'm sure. So don't lose that opportunity, as I said, go after that. And RBI did say that in case these things are not enough, we will take some more measures to help. So I think if things get rougher, they will. Okay, there's some more questions on cash, survival, employees. I think I've already spoken. Okay, the 90-day business mission. Yeah, sure. How to support it. We are so it's again resource crunch, but related to 90-day mission. So I must tell you that I insist that the 90-day mission should be helpful to the organization. It should add value to the organization. It should be a part and parcel of the organizational improvement plan for the year. See, you are involving your team, you are paying maybe sustenance allowance, but you are paying your team. So it must add value to the organization. Team also will get charged only then. So it's not an expense. It's a regular investment which you are planning to make to improve your organization. And don't forget that at the end of it, you will be fighting fit, able to reboot quickly, and therefore garner a lot of market share when the things improve. So I would say, take a 90-day mission and make sure it is productive, it is useful to the organization. Then you will not be asking me, this question. Okay, so what else is there? All right. So there is a general question on self. Of course, you have to find your own way to motivate yourself, and you have to stay above the above the point of power. And very importantly, you have free time. Some of the crises of the operation are not there. And you have to make sure that you are fit to stay in quadrant two, you know, where you are doing work for development, you are doing work for building better relations with your customer suppliers, and you are doing work for, you know, making your organization stronger and also your team stronger. I think I can do one more question. Yes, the team, right? So I think it's extremely important, you know, to keep your team intact. It's the answer is quite similar to the answer that I gave for the cash crunch question. So, you know, you can't lose the morale of your team at such stages, and they feel lost because they are not used to this environment. They don't know what will happen or not happen. So it's very, very important that you give them an inspiring mission. You contact them every day. You are leading from the front. You show them the positivity, and it's your energy and your positivity which will infect them, you know, to stay fit. So I would say that's important. Okay, guys, 2-3 minutes left. Maybe I can use this 2-3 minutes to thank you all again. I'm open. If anybody needs help, please feel free to mail me, and I could help you to put your 90-day mission in place, goals in place, or even discuss a couple of strategies with you. Once again, thank you very, very much for being here, and I have enjoyed giving this, and I